G'day, Chris here, and welcome back to Clickspring. In this video, I investigate and begin the process of constructing the lunar phase display assembly of the mechanism. If we were to select just one section of the Antikythera mechanism to serve as a representative test of the tool technology required to construct all that we see in the wreckage, then the lunar phase display assembly would surely be it. It provides direct evidence of precise forging, filing, turning and drilling, as well as indications of various bonding techniques. It's as close to the scale of modern watchmaking as the mechanism gets, and when limited to the tool technology of the day, by far the most demanding section of what we currently possess to construct. It also brings to the forefront the role that certain materials may have played in the construction of the mechanism. Just as how in our modern world, material science plays a major role in determining which engineering ideas can make it from the mind of a creator into physical reality, so too it was for the ancient makers. For example, there's more than a few ways to achieve a two-tone sphere representing the moon, and we can imagine the maker pondering how best to make this part. No evidence of the materials used remains, but it certainly needed to be light. As an experienced operator of the lathe, one option open to the maker was to turn the sphere from bonded slivers of light and dark wood, with ebony and holly being reasonable candidates to give a clear terminator between light and dark. If that was the choice that was made, then the requirement to bond the pieces of wood together implies a strong, durable glue. One possible candidate that immediately stands out is animal hide glue, a glue that predates the mechanism by at least 2,000 years. It's exceptionally strong, easy to prepare from what would have been commonly available materials, and leaves little trace of the join. One of the coarser files works well to pull back the edges of the workpiece to a reasonable starting point to begin turning on the lathe. Now, to be a useful component of the instrument, the sphere that's to come from this turning operation must be precisely divided into equal halves. So it's crucial that the centre axis of the workpiece be correctly defined. In this case, that comes down to careful placement of the pivot points. Once that's complete, this is followed by the other preparation work of both the lathe and workpiece that's required before turning can begin. Each cutting tool has its forte, and as it happens, this lozenge-shaped tool is well suited to the initial coarse cuts that start the process of bringing your workpiece to shape. The formation of this part is a good illustration of why watchmakers still use a tool much like this today for fine turning and repair work. Aside from the natural benefits of between centres turning, the immediate hand-to-eye response that comes from a single individual carefully driving both the bow and the cutting tool is essential for the fine, delicate control required to produce or repair some small parts. For me, the bow lathe is one of the purest expressions of turning. Each cut is a personal and instinctive response to what's come before it. So each choice ends up building upon the others as small and continuous course corrections on the way to a specific outcome. The feedback loop is direct and immediate. It's quite an intimate and directly human activity, more like drawing or painting than machining. The surface can be sealed with a natural oil, or as I've done in this case, a simple burnish leaves an interesting and presentable surface. The hide glue has performed well through this operation. The two species of wood have quite different hardness and density, and so naturally lead to a turning behaviour that feels a little like an interrupted cut. Yet the glue bond has remained strong throughout. Most importantly, the join line between the pieces of wood has made it through the turning process intact, remaining crisp and clearly defined. Now, in looking at the Antikythera wreckage for guidance on how a given part may have been made, generally the most helpful clues are the residual marks that ideally we can unambiguously associate with a well-understood process. Now, there are various reasons why this isn't always possible with many of the other components, but we're fortunate that the remains of the small crown wheel that drives the lunar phase ball has some distinctive detail. The scans show a pronounced folding over on the inside of the toothed recess. There's also a rounding of the base of the part and a general non-uniformity to both features. Now, to me, this suggests that the component blank was first forged, or perhaps more correctly, swaged into the initial shape of the part, and then the tooth and driving features were subsequently formed. And of course, we can apply a reasonableness test to this guess as part of the experimental process. At the very least, to be a contender for the actual fabrication process used in the ancient workshop, the final results generated here 2,000 years later should show similar residual evidence to what we can see in the scans, and I'll do a check of that later in this video. Now, I happen to like the idea of using this ball that was made in a previous video as the raw material for this part, but the beauty of the forging process is that the stock need not have been anything other than a conveniently sized piece of scrap that was then forged into shape. With a bit of experimentation, it became apparent that the fold-over feature that can be seen in the scans could be a product of the initial state of the blank prior to swaging. This also happened to be the most natural way of getting what will become the toothed wall section of the part to the correct thickness. For the main profile formation, I've made an open-faced swaging die from a billet of pure copper that was itself forged into shape, drilled, and then filed out to give a reducing funnel shape. As the part is swaged into shape, it becomes clear that some of the material at the edges just doesn't need to be there, and so it can be filed off, rather than forcing it all to conform to the shape of the die. Once the blank roughly conforms to the opening of the die, it can be repeatedly struck and then worked into shape. Both hot and cold working of the material are possibilities. Although I found the most controllable process to be modest cold working, followed by repeated annealing to alleviate work hardening. The process of swaging, annealing, and filing off excess material is then continued until the required shape of the blank is achieved. an opening for a driving square needs to be positioned at the centre of the workpiece. One possible way to achieve the correct positioning is with a punch tool that retains a residual turned pip on the end. This will leave a mark on the work that can then serve as a spotting recess for a drill bit to subsequently follow. I've prepared a second blank so that it can be split apart for a cross-check against the CT scans of the mechanism. The main details that I'm interested in seeing replicated are those associated with the forging and swaging process mentioned earlier, both of which do indeed resemble the scans. From here, the part follows the process used to form the teeth of the other gears of the mechanism, beginning with division. And if you've not seen it, then be sure to check out the video that describes this tool and the process in detail. I'll put a link below. I've cut a new needle file for the occasion of filing this next set of teeth, with the file sized to give good visibility of the part while conducting the cuts. The internal hole for the driving square and the slot on the back face of the part were then formed using cutting tools that I've made in a previous video. The parts that have been made so far, along with the shaft made in a separate video, can now come together to form the central sub-assembly of the lunar phase display. In the next video, the work continues to investigate and construct the rest of the gearing and the housing for this assembly. Thanks for watching. I'll see you later.